real relationships take vulnerability, and I sometimes will say everything like it is, so it can be very vulnerable. So I think that's why he wanted me to do it. Anyways, so today, last night when he was still feeling sick, I realized I was going to be preaching alone. So I was praying and just saying, Lord, what do you want to share with your people? And I didn't have a lot of time to prepare, so I just was like, okay, God, this needs to be from you, and it needs to be from me, you know, my delivery, because I can't preach your pastor's message. So you're going to get a little bit of stories and a little bit of just things that I love that God has shown me over the years, and I brought some of the things I love to share with you. So could we start with that song?
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry, none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet. The birds hush their singing, and the he gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Amen. That's my Jesus. Wow. So this is also one of my favorite country singers, Joey and Rory. And when I was in college, I went and saw them in person, and I loved it, and I followed their music over the years. Well, Joey and Rory had a beautiful love story, and then they waited years to have a baby, and then they had a baby, and that baby was born with Down syndrome. And then after the baby was born, Joey was diagnosed with cancer, and when little baby was about 2 years old, she died. But this song was written was sung not too long before that. And in the last couple years of her life, she recorded an album of the old hymns and just went back to those roots of loving Jesus. And so I know that when she died, I cried. But I thought, here she is. She's with Jesus. And so today I want to share with you about sharing Jesus. So our mission as Life Church is to know God and to share his love. And in this song it says, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, that's linger, wait there, spend time together, none other has ever known. Have you ever experienced that, a joy that no one else has known, just between you and Jesus? He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing. And the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And then she didn't sing this verse, but it goes, all around me is go through the voice of woe, and his voice to me is calling. And this song was actually written about Mary in the garden when she went to the tomb where Jesus had been laid and her Lord had been crucified. And she went to the tomb. But in the tomb, Jesus came out to meet her, and she assumed he was the gardener. But Jesus came, and he talked with her, and he shared with her, and he comforted her, and then he sent her back out to share with others. And so it's a beautiful story for her, but it's also beautiful for us. Jesus comes, and he comes into our lives, and he walks with us, and he talks with us. And then he invites us into this beautiful, authentic, real relationship, a relationship that's more real than any other relationship you will ever have or have ever had. And in that sweetness of his presence, he will talk to you, and he'll share things with you, and he allows you to be vulnerable with him and your real authentic self, and as you're with him. So Jesus is precious. Jesus is precious. And we are all on a journey. We're all on a journey with Jesus, whether we know it or not. And I have many friends that are in different areas of that journey. You know, some of my friends have totally rejected Jesus, but I still love them, and I'm still going to be their friend. You know, and some of my friends don't know him yet, and I have friends who believe that he was a good teacher. You know, but they don't really believe that he's God. And I have friends that would love God and have a relationship with God, and but they might not know Jesus as personally or as a close of a relationship. Maybe they would pray to Mary or someone else, but they would still believe in Jesus, and they're on a journey of knowing Jesus and knowing God. And so, and then there's others who know Jesus personally and close, but they're going through different struggles and things to understand, and they're having a hard time. And so no matter where you're at in this journey of knowing Jesus, we're all on a journey. And God wants us to share Jesus with everyone, and he wants us to share Jesus in our own way as well, like sharing his word, but in his way, in our way. So I brought you some of the things that I love. I love scones, and I love flowers, and I love tea. I inherited this from Bridget when I moved to Ireland, and when I was in the Philippines, my mom gave me this beautiful cup. And the first time I came to Ireland, my husband was trying to woo me at that time. We weren't even dating. I said, I'll come see Ireland, and you can show me around, and we'll see from there. So anyways, he bought me a beautiful bouquet, and it had these cabbage roses, and I had never seen them before in my life. So today when I went to look for flowers and I saw these, I said, oh, that's part of my story. I got to share them. And so, I love I love but the scones. When I first moved to Ireland, I didn't know how to make good scones. And my Barbara tells me these are not scones, these are rock buns. But scones in my head. Anyways, but scones, I just couldn't perfect the art of making scones. So finally one day I went to my neighbor, and Miss Peg was just lovely, older woman. And I said, Miss Peg, you got to give me your recipe for scones. And she said, I don't have a recipe. I've been making them since I was a girl. So I'm like, well, you have to show me. And so I went to her house with my mom because she was visiting. And she got out her flour, and she showed me how to make these scones. And my mom kind of wrote down, it's a little bit of this and about that much of that. And after that day, and since that day, about 10 years now, I've been making these scones, and they never have not turned out. They always turn out. So most people, when you come to my house, I'll whip up a batch of scones if I have all the ingredients. And it's something I can do in my head in 5 minutes, you know, or while preparing a message at 4 a.m. I can throw it together and pop it in the oven. And I love them. And there's nothing like a good scone with fresh butter. The only thing better is if you have homemade jam. And so my kids picked these berries, and my mother-in-law baked them in her, made it in the kitchen with the kids. And a good scone with butter and jam, homemade jam. No, you can't have any, it's mine. No, sorry. No, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. But, anyways, so I've tasted these scones, and I love to share them. And when we share Jesus, we should share them in the same way. So I love a good story. And another thing I love is I love charity shops. And I love to tell about them. So like this dress I got for €2. And I see the shocked look on your face. And most of my Irish friends say, don't say that. You know, keep that to yourself. But I love it. I love to tell the story. I went to a charity shop. I got the perfect dress. You can see it in Dunn's store. Or this one was Tesco, probably for €30. And I got it for $2. And isn't that so cool? You know? I mean, why wouldn't you be excited about that, you know? And so I love that. I love that. And I love a good story. But that's me, you know? And we are all so different. We're so unique. And we all have something like that that makes us come alive, that gives you an extra spark that just is like, I like that video game or whatever. You know, there's something that you love. And that's because God's made you, and He gives us the desires of our heart. He puts desires in us, and He makes us all unique with different gifts and abilities, and He gives us something to share. And so when I look around at this, like, just look at each other. Just look at each other right now. Look at each other. Wow, how much does God love Portlaoise? How much does He love Portlaoise? Look at you. You guys have come from all over the world. There's like 30 nationalities or more in this church. You have come from all over the world for all kinds of different reasons, but you've all come to Portlaoise. God has drawn you here. He's put you here on time for a purpose. He made you. He doesn't make mistakes. So you're here for a reason, for a purpose, a God-ordained purpose. Whether you thought so when you were coming or not, He's got you here because He loves Portlaoise, okay? This is a totally different sermon than I preached this morning. My notes were everywhere since I only found out I was preaching yesterday afternoon. But I got to share this, a town and a garden. Portlaoise. Look, a town and a garden. When we were praying about whether or not we would become pastors of this church, we had said no. But we were praying, and we felt like God said, consider and pray. And anyhow, that's a long story. But we sought the Lord. And when we were seeking the Lord about whether or not He wanted Noel and I to pastor this church, God gave me a dream. And it was a vision, and it was beautiful. You know, I love Portlaoise. I've loved Portlaoise from the moment I stepped foot here. But Portlaoise used to be called the armpit of Ireland, and it used to be called a dirty town. There's nothing more beautiful than Portlaoise. I love Portlaoise. And I've been to 33 countries around the world. I love Portlaoise. It's beautiful. Well, in this vision, I saw the Dublin Road as if you were coming off the motorway at exit 16 and you're coming down that motor that road into the town. And I saw the subdivisions and whatnot. There's Kilminchie and there's hotels and the hospitals, the prisons and all of that. And this town was known as a prison town, you know, the main employer. And it was a dirty town. Noel said, of anywhere, don't send me to Portlaoise. But in this dream that God gave me, I saw the Dublin Road, and as I was coming down the Dublin Road, kind of like a bird or plane or whatever it was, but anyways, coming down, I saw these huge and beautiful flowers just starting to blossom. I said, kind of like an Alice in Wonderland. I have never seen the movie, but how I would imagine these big flowers coming up, and they were just starting to blossom on both sides of the Dublin Road. And as I went down, they were blossoming, and it was so beautiful. The trees began to flower outside the prison. There were just flowers were just blossoming everywhere, and it was so beautiful. And God spoke to me, and he said, as my people come alive with the power and the passion of the Holy Spirit, I will make things beautiful. So that was in 2000, we said yes in 2016, so that was in 2015, end of 2015, that God gave me this vision. And he spoke many things to me, but it was so beautiful. And I said, God, I don't want to be a pastor's wife. I was a pastor's kid, but I don't want to miss out on what you're doing. I don't want to miss out on that. I say, yes, Lord, I'm all in. I don't want to miss out on what you're doing. He loves Portlaoise, and his vision for this town, for this nation, for all the nations is beautiful. And so this year, this sign went up around the city. And they planted wildflowers all along the Dublin Road and the other roads around. And I don't know if you've noticed in town, a lot of the shops put out flowers. There's flowers in the medians. There's flowers all across. People planted flowers all over benches that used to be brown and stained and whatnot. And now there's beautiful blue bench with pretty white and pink flowers. And there's just flowers. If you look around this town, I challenge you, go out and look around the town. See all the flowers everywhere around. And they marketed the town, and they said, Portlaoise, a town in a garden. And I'm telling you, that is because God has a dream for this place. That's God's dream coming to pass before our eyes, because God loves his people, and God loves you. And he loves this place so much, I'm telling you, you get to be here. You get to be here, and you're a part of his plan for this. And Jesus loves you, and he wants you to be a part of his story. And so, man, I have so much to share. Because, again, I love stories. I could tell you stories all day long. And I could listen to your stories. And I think that's why I get to be here in Ireland. Because Ireland's a country where people love stories. And they love to share. And so, but the best stories are God's stories. You know, the best stories are when God comes through and he changes situation. And so in my heart right now, you know, Marlena mentioned Israel, and that breaks my heart. And what's happening in Israel and what's happening to the Palestinian people too, you know, and what's happening in Gaza, what's happening all around the world. There's like people are hurting, and there's wars, and there's rumors of wars, and there's all of these things. And so today we are living in the end times. We are living in the end times. And now, my grandma and my grandparents, they thought that they were in the end times. And my grandpa thought Jesus was going to come back before he died, and he was sure of it. And my parents thought Jesus was going to come back in their time, and he still may because they're still living. But my dad quit college because he thought Jesus was going to come before he could get out of college. And why waste your life in college if Jesus is coming, you know? And so the disciples 2,000 years ago, they thought they were in the end times, you know? And so everyone's like, it's the end times. Well, I'm telling you, we're living in the end times. We're living in the end times. And I don't have time to really go into it, but just very, very brief. When I was 25 years old, I was in a major car accident. And I was on my way home. I was going home to have a tea party, of all things, and my friends were coming over, and I was in a hurry, and I crossed a major road, and a car ran into me, full speed, on a major road, and I was ejected from the vehicle. I went through the passenger window, broke the window with my head, was thrown underneath the vehicle. It was still moving. It rolled over me, went up the side, hit something, and rolled back over my body. And I was face down on the pavement, stretched out like this, without a scratch on my face. And I told a little bit more of the story. It's an amazing story. But I was 25 years old, and that was my day. I should have been dead. It was a big American F-150 pickup truck, if you know what those are. And I was hit by another major big American pickup truck that was going 65 miles per hour, like motorway speed. Like, that was my day. I should be in the ground right now. But God came. That's a God story. I can tell you more another day. That's a God story. He came. And that day, when I think, you know, I was airlifted to another hospital, I had that neck brace you see there where I couldn't turn my head to the right or to the left for 9 months. I spent 2 months in a hospital bed. I had 5 years where I had pain every single day, incredible pain and migraines. You know, doctors told me to my face that I would never be pain-free. But God came. God came and he changed my story, and I am saved and I am healed because of Jesus, and it's only because of Jesus. Yeah. There's at least 4, 5, 6 times that I know I should have been dead or could have been dead, would have been dead if Jesus hadn't shown up. Those are stories. God lets me have a lot of stories because I love to share them. And yeah, so that's a God story. When I think back on my accident, the picture I always see is I'm laying face down like I remember, but there's a big man lying on top of me, and he has an arm around my waist, and he has an arm around my face, and he's holding me. And when I went out, when I was ejected from the vehicle, I remember seeing this black blur, and I remember my head crashing against the glass. I remember the glass shattering, and I screamed, "Jesus, Jesus, I need you." The next thing I remember was laying there face down on the pavement, stretched out, and the world was silent. And I felt heavy and weighted and like I couldn't move. And all I could say was, "Jesus, Jesus, 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 Jesus." And you know the scripture in Romans 10:13, it says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." I called on Jesus. He came, and he saved me, and he held me. And the scripture says, by his stripes we're healed. So when the doctor said, you know, you'll never be pain-free, I said, no, my God saved me, and he's going to heal me. You know, and he did. 5 years later, it was pain, but he did. Jesus saves. So I know God saves. I know he heals, you know. And so today, there's this sense of urgency that whether we're in the last days, whether Jesus comes back literally to the earth to rescue this world, which I think he could come back in our lifetime with everything that's happening, you know, I mean, he's coming back to make a new heaven and a new world and to heal things where there's not going to be pain and suffering. There's not going to be all of this death and murder and stuff. He's coming back to make things right. And so he is coming, and I believe it's soon. But even if it's not in our lifetime, my day was up. I was 25 on the way to a tea party, and my day was up, but he rescued me. And so you don't know how long you have. You have no idea, but he does. So I just want to encourage you on your journey to Jesus, wherever you're at in this journey, take a step closer. Take a step closer. If you don't know him, ask somebody who does. And if you do know him, share him. Share him. But as you're sharing Jesus, I want to encourage you to share him.
Go on.
Like I share my scones or my dress or my stories. I don't want us as a church to go out and say, hey, you have to get saved today. You're going to hell. Jesus is coming. You know, some people are called to go out on the streets and preach the gospel. You know, we're all called, we're all called to do different things. Some people are called to go and give tracts and do things. We're all called to do different things. But as a church, I just want to encourage every single person to share Jesus. And the way I share Jesus is like this. You know, look at this. These are yummy. My neighbor taught me how to make them, and they're really good. You know, my parents told me about Jesus, and my grandma told me about Jesus, and I love to hear their stories. And one day, I got to know him, and his love filled my heart so much that he changed everything I did, you know? And Jesus is my friend. He's my comforter. He's the one I run to. He's the one when I'm flying out of a car, landing on the pavement, he's the one that I call. He's the one that I'm like, when my kids are sick, Lord, help them. In that incredible pain, you know, there was one night when I was in the most pain I've ever been in my entire life after my accident with my neck brace on. And I was in such incredible pain. I couldn't lay down. I couldn't sit up. I couldn't do anything but cry. And Jesus showed me himself. He said, I chose that pain for you. When he died on the cross, he chose pain. He chose my pain. And he chose to go through it for me so that I wouldn't have to. And he healed me. So when the measure of pain that I was experiencing, I realized was nowhere near the pain that he experienced on that cross. And I would never want to go through that pain again. But he willingly chose to do it for me. So in that moment of pain, man, I learned so much about my Jesus and that incredible love that he has for me. Wow. If he was willing to go through more than this for me, wow, he must love me, you know? And so Jesus, I've experienced that love of Jesus, and I'm learning more about him every day. And so as I try my scones with different jams or different things, you know, I get to taste them. I get to experience it. And then I'm like, I like this. Hey, you want to try it, you know? And then I share it. And as I share it, it's something that I'm excited about. It's something that I have experience with. It's something that I love. And I want us each to share Jesus that way. Think about it. What is it about you? What is it about your life that you love? And your friends, how can you share him with them? You know, are you going through pain? Are you really struggling with taking care of your kids? Or what is it in your job? Or how can you share Jesus lovingly from that experience in a loving and just encouraging way? God wants to use your story to share his story. Yeah. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. The voice I hear, he whispers in my ear, so sweet, the birds hush their singing. So today, everybody looks solemn and sad. Maybe you're thinking, but I just want to encourage you guys. Let's share. Get to know God, and to share his love. Get to know him personally, enjoy him, and share him with others. And that's my challenge to you today. And maybe we could play that song, I Speak the Name of Jesus. I want to just end us with a song, just lifting up the name of Jesus. And wherever you're at in your story, if you don't know him and want to pray with someone, we're here to pray with you. If you're struggling and you want to pray with someone, we're here. But today, let's lift up our eyes and look to Jesus. And, yes, thank you for putting this one on. And love where you live. This was in Portland. Love where you live. God has planted us here to love where we live, to love our neighbors, to love our friends, to love our families, and to just bring his light into this world.
Yeah.
We praise you. So God, we just thank you for this day. God, I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are alive and you are good. And you love us, Lord Jesus, and you love Portlaoise. And you love each of us no matter where we are on our journey, Lord. And I just thank you, Jesus, that your name is peace. Lord, your name is healing. I've experienced it, Lord Jesus. Your name is power. You are powerful to save, Lord Jesus. I've seen it, and I know it. And so, God, I pray for those that need your power right now, Lord Jesus, that you would pour out your strength on them. And those that need your healing, Lord Jesus, that they would receive healing from you because you give it freely. Lord, I pray for those who don't know you, that you would open the eyes of their hearts to see you and understand how much you love them and how you died for them because you love them. So I pray, Lord Jesus, that today would be a day of salvation. Today would be a day where your name would be glorified and you would draw all men to yourself. And Lord, I pray that we would be fruitful. We would go out and we would bear fruit. We would eat of the fruit that you've given us and we would share it with others and see others nourished and thrive, Lord, because of what you've done in our lives as we share our stories. I pray you'd give courage that people would get out there and just share your love and their stories that you've given them with others, that people would be lifted up, encouraged, strengthened, and just help them to take another step closer to you. Thank you, Jesus, that you're coming again. And we want to be ready when you come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen.